Hi, I remain your reliable friend, Joseph Shadrach, popularly known as Shabash. Today, I'll be giving us some tips and guidelines on how to warm up before hitting your drum set. As a drummer, there are some necessary exercises we're supposed to do to avoid injuries while playing our drum set. Listen attentively and watch me while I demonstrate those exercises to you. First and foremost, the hand exercise. We'll be basically working on all the parts we'll be using for playing: our legs, our hands, and the mental exercise. But first and foremost, we'll start with the physical exercises. Our hands, you push your hand forward, then bend your palm. Just you can do it for as long as 1 minute, 2 minutes, 3 minutes. Then when you're done with this one, the next exercise you move those two palms to your shoulders like this, as if you're hugging yourself. As soon as you're done with this, you bend to the left while your head moves to the right, like this. As soon as you're done with this, you do the same thing to your left and right. Okay, we take it once more. You move your head to your right hand side while your shoulder tilts to the left. When you're done with that one, you move your head to your left hand side while you tilt your shoulder to the right. Watch me carefully, like this and like this. Once you're done with this, you take your stick, hold them together, bend it carefully like this. Then you bend your hands toward inside out. Yeah, we work on the shoulders, our elbows, and the fingers. If you can do it for 1 minute, 2 minutes, 3 minutes, 4, 5 minutes, you bring it out, you relax it. Yeah, relax a bit for 30 seconds. Now we'll be doing for the right hand only, like this, while your left hand remains steadfast. You do it for a minute, two or three. You bring it back. You do the same thing for your left hand. You can last the same minute also. You bring it out. As soon as you're done, relax for 30 seconds. Then, apparently we are done with our hands. Then the next thing we'll be going towards is our legs. We're all familiar with the heel top, and the heel down. So we take our right leg, put it on the left leg, as if you're crossing your leg. Watch me carefully. Let me move my drum set backwards so that I can be comfortable enough. Like this. Yep. You can do it for the same number of minutes as earlier said. You drop it. Do the same thing for your left leg also. You drop it. You relax for 30 seconds. I'm sure the whole body now is ready for hitting the drum set. Then the last exercise I want to talk about is the mental exercise. Getting familiar to the song, the track that you want to play along with. You just listen to it so that you get all your body from your head to your toe relaxed. When you're done with this exercise, then just take a cool shower or a nap, 15, 20, 30 minutes before the main gig. I'm sure I've done justice to this. Thank you very much and enjoy this. Hello, welcome to yet again another interesting topic that we'll be discussing today. And guess what? How to hold the drumstick. How to hold the drumstick. We all love tea and bread, right? But we don't have a single way of preparing tea and bread. Some will say, get the hot water, pour the milk, the Bonvita, then the sugar. Others will say, pour the milk, pour the Bonvita, sugar, then water. Different ways of preparing tea. That's the same way for drumstick. We have different ways of holding the drumstick. But the two most important ways of holding the drumstick, these are the match grip and the traditional grip. You heard me clearly? The match grip and the traditional grip. Under the match grip, we have three ways of holding the stick. The German way, the American way, and the French way. While under the traditional grip, we just have one traditional grip. So let me take you on the journey of how to hold the drumstick. First, we're talking about the match grip. First and foremost, we'll be talking about the match grip. Number one on the item is the German grip. Watch me closely. The reason why it's called the match grip is because both hands are evenly matched. They hold the stick the same way. So now let's go back to the German ways of holding the drumstick. Watch my palm. You open your palm. Let's work with the right hand first. You open your palm closely. Drop the stick properly in between your palm. Use your fixed index finger to wrap the stick. Then use the last three fingers to complete the wrapping. Then your thumb on it. Then you tilt it, palm facing down, like this. Let me go over it again once more, so that you can see it properly. Get your drumstick, open your palm, separate your first index finger from the other three. Drop the stick on the palm, use the first index finger to hold it like this. Use your three fingers to wrap it, then your thumb to hold it. As soon as you're done holding it like this, what next? You face it down. This is called the German grip. I know you've understood this properly. So we'll do the same thing for the left hand. Like this. This is our German grip. I wouldn't want to hit the snare. But I'm sure we are cool with this German grip. So the next we'll be talking about, the American grip, is quite similar to the German grip. Only that instead of the 90 degrees like this, it's going to be 45 degrees. I'll repeat myself, instead of the 90 degrees like this, it's going to be 45 degrees. So the German is like this, why the Americans like this? Watch me closely. The German is like this, why the American is like this? Okay. Watch me closely. The German is this way. Why the American is this way? Watch it closely. German, this way. Your palm is facing down. Watch my elbow. 90 degrees. Where about then the American is like this. Tilting towards 45 degrees. This way. As soon as you're done with the German like this, American like this, then the third one is the French grip. I don't want to bore you guys with holding the drumstick, but I just want to show us the tilting. That's what differentiates this three match grip together. The tilting of the hand, that's what differentiates the French grip, the American grip, and the German grip. Now, in the French grip, can you see it clearly? Or you want for better explanation? The German is like this, American is 45 degrees. Then the French grip, it's your palm is facing heaven or facing both. They're facing each other. And mind you, the French, it's quite different from the German and American. The major difference between the French and these two is, instead of your palm facing down or 45 degrees, your palm face up like this. The reason for this is to ensure flexibility of your finger. Most of the strokes, they are done by the help of your fingers when you're using the French grip like this. The fingers like this. So let me do a recap of these three. The German grip is like this. The American is like this. Why the French is like this? Watch closely. The German grip is this way for better clarification. The American grip is this way, while the French grip is this way. I will go over it again. German grip, American grip, French grip. Then finally, we'll be talking about the traditional grip. Here's the twist to the traditional grip. Open your palm facing up. We'll be working with the left hand this time. Your palm will face up this way. Take your drumstick. Put it the space between your index finger and your thumb, just like this, and let it relax properly. Once the stick relaxes in between the space, tilt it a little bit to drop in between your four fingers. Let the stick rest at the center. Then what? Your first two fingers bend it like this. Then you curve this inward. This is our traditional grip. Ensure that the stick is free and flexible for better rebound, like this. I'll run over it again. Open your palm like this, facing up. Separate the four fingers, two to each side. Drop the stick in between the space. The space between your first index finger and your thumb. Then tilt the stick to drop at the center of both of your four fingers. Then curve the first two on it, then the last two to curve beneath it. That's your traditional grip. Then you can hold the right hand any way you choose to, either the German grip for louder sound, the American grip, or the French grip. But for the purpose of this, because this traditional grip is mostly used for jazz players, you are advised to use the French grip. Thank you and have a lovely day. Hello viewers out there, welcome to yet another interesting topic. We'll be talking about getting to know your drum set, getting to know your drum kit. We'll be taking the drum kit one after the other and labeling them in your own eyes. Listen attentively so that you don't miss out on anything. First and foremost, we'll be talking on what we call, some persons call it the drum beater, some call it the pedal. This is the pedal. It's used to hit what we call the bass drum. The pedal is mounted upon by your right foot to give a constant pulse, or a two-way pulse in between your 4-4 time signature. It comes on the count one and the count three. It's called what? The beater. Next on our list is what I call the bass drum itself. The bass drum, it's the biggest of all the drum. The beater is attached to the bass drum to give that resound boom sound. Listen to the sound. The next on the list is what I called the high tom or the rack tom. This is the high tom or the rack tom. It varies in shape. Some drummers prefer size 10, while some prefer size 12, some prefer size 13. It varies in shape for different kind of music genre. Next on my list is what I called the rack tom 2. Yeah, you heard me clearly. Rack tom 2 or the low tom. It's mounted side by side with your tom 1. Both are mounted upon your bass drum. It also comes in different shape. Similar to the tom 1, the shape varies from 13, 15, 16, depending on the genre of music. Next to the tom 2 is what I call the floor tom or the side tom. We all know what the side tom is. The biggest of all the tom, aside the bass drum. It comes in different shape also. It has three handle or three legs that helps it to stand on its own. Usually it's not mounted on the bass drum. This is your floor tom. Next on our list is what I call the hi-hat. The hi-hats are two cymbals attached together on a stand that helps to add a feel to the music. It's been mounted on a hi-hat stand that has a pedal, which is usually and mostly handled by our left foot. For the purpose of clarification, the next item I will bring in on our list will be the hi-hat stand, so that we'll know what it looks like, and I'll mount both to see how it looks like. This is our hi-hat stand. So I'll be putting a hi-hat on the stand. This is our hi-hat foot pedal for the left leg. And also, for the record, hi-hats are part of the cymbals instrument. We have the hi-hat cymbals, we have the crash cymbals, we have the China cymbals, and we have the right cymbals. So I'll be delving into all the cymbals. We're done with the hi-hats, so the next cymbal on our list will be what? The China cymbal. This is a China cymbal. It's usually curved. If you can see the curve, it's not over like other cymbals. It's curved to give us a unique feel in our playing. The next on the cymbal list will be our crash cymbal. This is our crash cymbal. It's mounted on our left hand side, directly opposite our snare drum, but on a higher stand that makes it to stand above the snare drum. I'll be bringing the crash cymbal. I'll be bringing the stand so that we'll see how it looks like on its stand. Here we have the crash cymbal stand, which we'll be mounting our crash cymbal on it. The next item on our list will be what? The biggest of all the cymbals. It's called the right cymbal. It's mounted on our right hand side, above our floor tom. It gives a unique feel. You can alternate between your hi-hat and the right cymbal, especially when you play the bell. It gives a unique feel to our music. And I'll be bringing the right cymbal stand to mount it on it so that we'll see what it looks like. This is the stand for the right cymbal. There's a tilt on it, so we lose the tilt or the screw. Then we'll mount the cymbal on it. Then you tie. The next item on our list will be what? Sorry, it's like I missed something out. We'll be bringing the hi-hats, the China cymbal. It has its own stand also, so that we'll mount it on it, so that we'll have our complete cymbals on their stand. This is our another stand that we'll be mounting our China cymbal on it. It has a screw on it also, so that when playing, the cymbal will not be flying here and there. That is the purpose of this screw, to help guide the cymbals from falling off. Last but not the least is the main, one of the main drum itself, which I call the snare drum. This is the snare drum on its stand. One of the most important of the five-piece drum is the snare drum, because it gives us the real pulse of the music, the real feel of the music. Most of the time, it's been hit on the two, on the count two and the count four of the 4/4 time signature. This is the stand of the snare drum. And the reason why this stuff is called the snare drum, it's because of the snare beneath it that gives it that crispy sound. And last on our list is one very important thing, that without that stuff, this whole thing will not be complete, which is what I call the drum throne. Some call it the drum seat. You can't set all these kits and perform anything without the drum throne. So it's another important part of the drum kit, the drum throne. For you to be a respected drummer, you must be behind a drum. And how do you be behind a drum without the drum throne? So this is our drum throne. It varies in shape and sizes. Some come with back part where you can relax your back, but I prefer the one without the back so that I can be on the guard. Thank you very much. These are drum kits, and once more I will go over them once again so that you can remind yourself of this. As a drummer, if you don't know all the parts of your drum kit, you're not worthy to be called a drummer. So once again, I'll be holding this. Memorize them. You can mute this video and try to recall if you get them one after the other. First and foremost, this is our China cymbal. This is our crash cymbal. Our right cymbal. Our hi-hat. Our snare drum. Our bass drum, the bass drum beater or the pedal, tom one, high tom or the rack tom one, rack tom two, low tom, and finally floor tom or the side tom. And there's a hanger in which these two toms are being hung on. I'll be showing us, that's the last item on our list. This is how your hanger looks like, in which tom 1 and tom 2 are being hung on. So for better clarification, I'll be doing practicalizing it for us so that I know what it feels or what it looks like. So as a drummer, once you come across dismantled kits like this, you know how to identify them and how to fix them on their various positions. The next lecture will be on how to assemble our drum kits. Do have a lovely day. Thank you. I remember your loyal boy and your loyal servant, Joseph Shedrack, also known as Shabash. And welcome to what? Golden Touch Music Academy. Peace. Hello. In our last lecture, we spoke about getting to know your kit. On today's lecture, I'll be talking on how to assemble your drums. So should in case you see the kit scattered everywhere, here and there, you know what and what part fits into one another. Sit back, relax, and watch how I assemble my 5-piece drum. First, I get my drum set. Get it positioned at the center of where I'll be playing. If it doesn't suit me, I readjust it and ensure that it properly sits on where you're playing. After getting your drum set fixed, the next item on the list will be your bass drum. When I say bass drum, you all know what bass drum means, the biggest of them all. You get your bass drum, ensure that your right foot is directly facing your bass drum. Once this is settled, the next thing on the list will be getting our pedal. Once you get your pedal, fix it on the bass drum and ensure that you still have that your leg fits straight to the bass drum. Then after fixing this, we get what? Our snare drum. We're fixing them in order of priority to me. The next one will be my snare drum. Once you get the snare drum, as you can see, my snare drum is already mounted on its stand. Ensure that the snare drum sits in between your left and your right leg, like this, for flexibility in playing. The snare drum should sit in between your left leg and your right leg, just like this. As soon as you're done, the next item will be what? Getting our mounter. I call it a mounter, some persons call it handle. This handle is used for holding our tom 1 and our tom 2. Like this, you fix it. There's a hole on top your bass drum. Loosen it. Once it fits in, then you screw back. Once this is done, definitely we know we'll be moving to our toms. Tom 1 or tom 2. We'll be taking the tom 1 as the first item to be fixed on the mounter. There's a screw here. You loosen it to ensure that this fits into this. Just like this. Once this is settled, you screw back. Don't have what we call, there's an adjuster here. You loosen it to ensure that your tom comes forward like this. Then you tighten it. Once this is settled, you go and get your tom 2. Just the same way with what we did for the first tom, we'll do the same thing for the second tom. Sorry? He puts it upside down. All right. Just like this. Once this is settled, what? You do what? You screw. Just like this, so you can adjust both together. Like this. Then what will be the next thing? You get your hi-hat. Our hi-hat is already mounted on the stand. You adjust it. Remember, I said our right leg should be forward facing our bass drum. We'll be doing the same thing for our left leg to ensure flexibility while playing. While your snare drum remains at the center of both your right leg and your left leg, your hi-hat should be closer to it. Just like this. So now we are done. This is the basic setup. So what next? We'll be looking at our floor tom. This is our floor tom. We'll be dropping it at the side. As the name implies, floor tom or the side tom. We have our basic setup. So the next thing we'll be moving to our cymbals. From the China cymbal to the crash cymbal to the right cymbal. I remember what I said earlier on. Our right cymbal should and will always be at our right hand side. The crash cymbal will be at our left hand side, above our snare drum and our hi-hat, while the crash can be anywhere around the kit, from the right to the left or to the center in between our thumbs. But for this purpose, our China cymbal will be close to our crash cymbal. So the next item will be mounting our crash cymbal like this. Then we'll get our right cymbal to the right. Then our crash cymbal. You can put it here or here. So if you're putting it close to the right cymbal, then you have to reduce the height of the right cymbal, so they'll have a proper way of hitting the China cymbal, just like this. This is a proper setup of a five-piece drum set. Your hi-hat to the left, your floor tom to the right, tom 2, tom 1, snare drum, crash cymbal, China cymbal, and your right cymbal. Then the bass drum and the beater. This remains our drum throne. Then for playing pleasure, we now introduce what we call our drum stick. So I'll just go over it once more. This is our drum seat. This is our crash China cymbal, I beg your pardon. This is our crash cymbal. This is our hi-hat. This is our snare drum. This is our tom 1. This is our tom 2. This is our floor tom. And this big guy here is our bass drum. Then the beater for the bass drum, our pedal. Our pedal. Then our drum seat. Yes. This is our pedal. Then this is our drum seat. Then the person behind all these kits happens to be a drummer. I remain your drum tutor. Shabash. Do have a lovely day. Thank you. Hello. Welcome to another interesting topic that we'll be discussing today. You're familiar with your drum kits. You know how to assemble your drum kits. So what we'll be talking about is how to tune that kit of yours. For the record, there's no universally accepted ways of tuning the drum set, but you can tune the drum set to suit your own ear and the kind of music you'll be playing or you're playing. So for the purpose of this lecture, I'll be giving us a simple analogy or a simple demonstration on how to tune your drum. Just the basic for every beginner. Watch and listen attentively. First and foremost, I'll be using the bass drum as an example for how to tune any part of the drum. We have two layers, the under layer and the overhead layer. For you to tune your drum, first, you must ensure that you cover both the under and the top. For the under, for reference purpose, ensure that the under layer of your drum is properly locked. When I mean locked, locked properly with your fingers before you start using the drum key. Okay? When you want to tune your drum set, this is what is required. The drum key. We have them different shapes, but the same size. So you lock everything. For this floor tom, it has just 6 knobs. So we'll be keying them, tight them properly, tight to the teeth. Once you're done with the under layer, you can now turn to the overlayer or the upper layer. It's keyed properly. Now you see that it's wrinkled. So what you're supposed to do to erase wrinkle, we use our fingers to tight everything properly. Properly. And once it's locked and you discover that your hands can no longer tight it, that's when you become your drum key. I'll show us the way it's supposed to be done. You're not to start locking them 1, 2, 3. That's the wrong way of locking them. You lock them 1. You count 1, 2. Then lock the one that is directly opposite it 1 turn. Then you come to this one here. 1 turn. Then you go to the one opposite it. 1 turn. Then you go to this. 1 turn. You go to this. 1 turn. When you're done with the 1 turn, look at the drum. The reason why I'm pushing it like this, I want to see if you still have any place that's having any wrinkle. There's no wrinkle. You do another 1 turn. 1, 2, this, and this, until you get the required sound that suits you. Thank you very much. Welcome to another interesting topic. We'll be talking about sitting posture for a drummer and leg technique for a drummer. I go again. Sitting posture and leg technique. So we'll be talking about this sitting posture. The best way for any drummer of any genre of music to sit down properly is to sit upright. When I mean upright, there's a 90 degree between your lap and your body. a 90 degree between your lap and your body, and a 90 degree between underneath your lap and your leg. I'll go over it again. There's a 90 degree between your your leg and your lap. That's the joint. That's your knee joint. And there's a 90 degree between your lap and your body. That's your waist angle. Once you sit like this, be rest assured, you're going to have a flexible and a smooth plane. And remember, sitting well, it translates to playing well because you are more relaxed. I'll run over it again. A 90 degree position between your body and your lap, then a 90 degree between your leg and also your lap. That's between your elbow joint and your waist joint. Once you can achieve that 90 degree, then you are the right sitting position for playing. Next on the list will be our leg technique, our foot technique. We have two basic foot techniques, the heel top and the heel down. So I'll be explaining the heel top. What do I mean by the heel top technique? The heel top technique simply means playing the beater while your heel, behind your heel, is up. Playing the beater while behind of your heel is up. And while the heel down technique is, you're hitting the beater and your leg is flat on the pedal. I'll go over it again. The heel top technique, simply put, means the front of your heel is directly on the beater, whereas this part of your heel, that's back of your leg, is slightly above the beater. These kind of techniques are mostly used by metal drummer, hard rock drummer, but for jazz drummer, they mostly make use of the heel down technique. And the heel down technique is just opposite to the heel top because you play the beater while your foot is just flat on the pedal. I hope this lesson helps you. But for any aspiring drummer, I would advise you use both techniques. You can change them while you play. Sometimes you want to relax while the music goes on, you can use your heel down technique. And if you want to hit it hard, you can use your heel top technique. You can use them interchangeably. To have a wonderful day. Thank you. Hello, viewers. Welcome to yet another interesting topic. Introduction to beginners basic groove. So we'll be playing a 4/4 time signature to illustrate this. If you go to our student manual, page 34, I'll be illustrating a quarter note, an eighth note, and 16th note. I'll play the basic groove for you all to listen to. And I'll be using 60 BPM to illustrate this. Listen attentively. On the first line or the first exercise, we have a quarter note pause on our hi-hat. Then, on the eighth note, there's an eighth note pause on the hi-hat. One and two and. Then the third exercise is a 16 note pause. One, E, and R. So listen attentively. I'll play the first exercise 4 times. Then I'll play the second one 4 times. Then I'll play the third one, the 16 note, 4 times. So listen attentively. So that I don't need to pause or just move from one to the second to the last one. good with this exercise. So the next one is incorporating the three of them into one bar. That means we're playing into one measure, sorry. We're playing them one bar each. The first bar is the quarter note. The second bar is the eighth note. Then the third bar is the 16th note. So listen attentively. First one.